Hi, welcome to the Secret Superbetter Book Club, where we will be hanging out with some of the coolest people who have been reading Superbetter and using Superbetter and researching Superbetter. And I thought it would be just really fun to get some of the most exciting, interesting, creative people who are part of the Superbetter community to come and hang out with us today. So that's what we'll be doing. And we have 9 super cool people joining us live. And you can ask some questions in the chat if you would like to ask some questions yourself. Now, I thought a really good way to start this book club would be to give you some updates on what's been going on with Superbetter research over the past year since the book went into print. There are actually a few new studies that are really exciting and relevant. And so here are research updates from the science of games. Now, many of you will remember, of course, the studies from Oxford University showing that playing Tetris for 10 minutes within 6 hours of a trauma could help prevent flashbacks, so it could be used as a kind of cognitive vaccine for PTSD. Well, it turns out that the Oxford researchers have done another study pushing that horizon of help a little bit further. And their new study shows that you can use Tetris as a cognitive vaccine for PTSD for preventing flashbacks 24 hours after the trauma. And the one additional element of the technique is that you kind of have to prime the memory of what you're trying to avoid a flashback about by just thinking about, remembering, recalling briefly, just for 30 seconds before you start playing Tetris, the incident that you would like to avoid flashbacks from. So you kind of re-trigger the memory, play Tetris for 10 minutes, and that can help prevent the symptoms of PTSD. So that's very exciting. It doesn't have to be within 6 hours of the trauma. It can be 24 hours. Because obviously, if you've just been through a traumatic experience, you may not really get it together within 6 hours to play a video game. So that's super cool. Update number one. Oh, this is nice. I see all the viewers joining. So welcome to our book club, you guys. So the second research update that I want to share with you has to do with Tetris again for craving. So you may remember the studies in the book about playing a game like Tetris or any visual pattern matching game, Candy Crush Saga or the card game set, to reduce cravings. So there's an update on this research as well. The same researchers who did the two studies that are written about in the book did an additional study testing this theory out in the wild. So the original studies were done in the laboratory and trying to prevent people from eating junk food in the laboratory. They decided to test it in the wild over the course of a week, and they found that this technique was effective. Again, playing Tetris or Candy Crush Saga type games for 10 minutes was effective at reducing cravings in the real world, not just in a laboratory. And it was effective not just for junk food, but also for cigarettes and alcohol as well. So that's a new study update, and that was really exciting. The last study update I wanted to share with you is about developing empathy or compassion for other people through playing games. There's a lot of research in chapter 2 in the book about being surrounded by allies. New research showing that playing Rock Band with somebody for 15 minutes changes how your brain processes that person from being a stranger to being a friend. And it actually has more impact than giving somebody, and I wrote down the name of this drug. The drug is called metirapone, and I'm sure I'm mispronouncing that, but it reduces the fight or flight response so that you don't feel stressed out about interacting with strangers. And playing the video game actually had a better impact than this drug. So it's a kind of common theme in Superbetter studies that a game had as much benefit or more than a typically prescribed drug, and that it actually helped you sort of transition in your mind that you process that person the way you would process a close friend, an intimate friend, someone you really care about, as opposed to somebody you don't know at all in just 15 minutes of video game play. So that's pretty cool. So, you know, bring out the musical video games. Okay, so it's time for our first guest, who I'm really excited about, and we are going to attempt to add them. This is, by the way, this is my first time doing a live on-air hangout, so I could be ridiculously bad at this, but let's see if we can invite the esteemed psychologist Scott Barry Kaufman to join. So we are giving him a call, and we'll see if he is able to join us. By the way, there are 24 of you in here, and I feel like, let's see, what am I doing? I wonder, can I see you guys? Can I see questions you're asking? Yes, okay, so I've opened the Q&A app. And hopefully you will be able to add questions now. So that will be really cool. And let's see if I'm attempting to invite somebody to join me, but I don't know that it's working. So while I'm trying to get this person to join me, I feel like you guys should type me some questions that you would like to have answered, or just say hi to each other. Invite. Come on. Let's see. How are your puppies doing? This is a test. I like that question. I'm going to answer that question. My puppies are doing great. Thank you for asking. Always important. I should have pictures of puppies. Let me try bringing in another guest who I know is on the call now. Let's see. Invitation posted. So Chelsea Howe, you should check your invitations to see if you've got an invitation to come join this and show up. And in meanwhile, I will answer another question. Oh, here's Miss Chelsea Howe. Excellent. Well, if anybody else is watching who is supposed to be a live guest, Chelsea, how did you get into this?
I was watching a live stream, and I actually had to pause that window, and I minimized it, and I tucked it away, and I went to my actual Gmail account and accepted the call from there.
Okay. Well, let me talk to Chelsea, and then Chelsea, we may have to chat for a really long time if I can't figure out anybody else. So Chelsea Howe is one of the most amazing game designers in the world. You are the creative director for mobile games at EA.
The Red Crow Studio.
The Red Crow Studio. And you were my original co-designer on the Superbetter app and web platform. So you have a long history with but that's not what we're here to talk about today, because I invited all of the Superbetter Book Club pre-order members to send questions in advance and things that they're interested in. And when you and I talked about what you would like to chat about, you suggested something that people have actually asked about a lot, which is the phenomenon of live streaming your video gameplay. And why do people love to stream their gameplay, and why do people love to watch other people playing games? So we're talking about Twitch and YouTube's game streaming. So Chelsea, what is going on? Why are people so involved?
Yeah, so I'm super excited about this, but a lot of people's initial reaction is like, that's like the worst, craziest, silliest thing you could do is like watch someone else play a game. Like, why would you ever want to watch someone else play? And yet we're seeing millions of people on Twitch watching a single person or a single tournament. And I think the idea of watching a tournament kind of points to this underlying motivation, which is that when you stream, you're creating an event for people to share together. And especially for those who love games, someone streaming that game is an open invitation for someone to go to an event that is about this thing that they love and share it with all of these other people. You even see things like in Twitch, there's these emoticons and it creates this unique jargon. So you're actually establishing this micro community united around something that everyone is passionate about, everyone loves. You can watch people fail at it. You can watch people play it in really, really weird ways. You're seeing a lot of the, sorry, that's my beeping. If you're trying to turn it off. you see people playing something like Super Mario, like on the original NES. And so it's also this nostalgia element. If you just went out and tried to find someone at a coffee shop and were like, hey, let's go play the old Nintendo on NES, you probably wouldn't be able to find someone. But the internet's letting these like very diverse people come together around really what used to be niche topics and then flooding those channels with new eyes, younger audiences, younger generations who didn't grow up with that, and they're getting to relive it and re-experience it. Mm. And there's something really special about seeing someone experience something that you experienced in your childhood for the first time. So there's a lot of people who are younger and who are streaming themselves playing these older games, and people love uniting around that. So
I want to see people start to stream Infocom text adventures. Is anybody doing that? I have not seen any of that.
Oh yeah, yeah. Someone was streaming Zork.
that's my niche. That's my niche. I would like to watch that. That's cool. So what is there? You know, is there a lesson for, you know, sort of the like, what are people getting from that they're not getting from other media that was like, is there a sort of bigger lesson from this?
I think it's the idea, like the power of synchronicity and the power of like events. So when you think about most communities on the web, like it's very static. It leaves a trail. So you can just show up at any time and kind of see the history. If you think about the popularity of Snapchat, I think that's kind of similar. It's something that is in the moment, spontaneous. You get that one exposure to it. Hey, Scott.
Hey.
Welcome.
Thank you.
And then it's done. And that's kind of what streaming is it's that opportunity to unite around an event. And now we're seeing Twitch channels start to get interactive. And so it's not just you passively watching. It's you actively engaging and uniting around this experience, which is really fun.
Right, which is, and we've got some interesting comments here in my Q&A, you know, that it's people searching and finding that lets them feel connected. It's the response to the culture we live in. That's very cool. If you have comments about this, you know, definitely put them in this little Q&A app, and I will post them up, I think, for people to see. I think you guys can see that comment from Tim Sweeney. So, Chelsea, you're going to give us a power-up before you go, and also meet Scott Barry Kaufman, esteemed founder of the Imagination Institute. Scott, meet Chelsea. I know you guys are going to combine superpowers in the coming months in interesting ways that are part of our secret superhero plans. Chelsea, so we're asking everyone for a power-up today, and I thought, you know, you're such an expert on positive emotions in games and which games help us provoke different positive emotions. So I thought, could you recommend for all of us a game that we could play, maybe mobile games that's really easy to fit into our lives, to provoke a particular positive emotion?
Definitely. So I actually asked you the question about puppies to be a nice lead-in. I love hanging out with my dogs. It's one of my biggest power-ups. But during work, I obviously can't bring them with me. And so I found this really fun game called, that's been popular recently, called Neko Atsume. And it's a Japanese game about collecting cats. And it's just about the simplest game you could ever experience. You literally just go into the game, you leave out little things for cats, and then when you come back, you might have cats. And there are all sorts of different cats, and you can take pictures of them. I don't know if you can see this, but those are all of my cats right now.
They bring you sardines or dead fish, or they bring you dead things, and then you which is awesome, just like cats.
And you never know which one you're going to see. So it's incredibly simple, and it's just this little moment of surprise, and you never know which cat's going to be there. There are rare cats that only show up under certain circumstances.
And so it's always this little moment of just surprise and delight and joy. Super simple. Anyone can pick up.
And the name is hard, but it's just Google Japanese cat game, and everybody will find it. That's how I originally found it. And if I could add, Chelsea, I feel like another feeling that game delivers really effectively is mastery, because it's all in Japanese. There's no English translation, and so you.
There are now.
Oh, there are? When did that happen?
They just came out with an English version.
Oh, well, that will make it easier for people to play. I've been playing the version where all of the instructions are in Japanese, and you're just like clicking around, and what does this do? And I felt really cool. So, okay. But you could potentially still play the Japanese version and learn a little Japanese, and that's cool too. Well, Chelsea, thank you for joining us and passing the baton and for elucidating the Twitch phenomenon a little bit, because it's definitely going to be one of the most important, you know, aspects of what does it mean to create community. It's not just about games, you know, it's about building community. Thanks, Chelsea.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
And now we're joined by Mr. Scott Barry Kaufman, all the way from Philadelphia. I should mention Chelsea's joining us from Austin. Scott, how are you doing?
I'm great. Sorry I'm late.
That's okay. Tell us how you got in, because if I have this problem with our other guests, we want to be able to tell them how to get in.
I had to actually go and start streaming. I started streaming our event, and then I was able to see the proper invitation.
Ah, okay. So that's the key. Okay. Awesome. Well, welcome. And I want to talk to you today about two things. For folks who don't know Scott is a really well-known researcher of creativity and more recently imagination. And he runs the Imagination Institute at the University of Pennsylvania. And you've just founded that. You've just kicked off this research initiative. Tell people what it is.
Sure, yeah. I run it with Martin Seligman, who many people might be familiar with in the field of positive psychology. He started this movement to really understand what it means to live a good life, what it means to live a fulfilling life, a meaningful, fulfilling life, not necessarily like publicly recognized success, but actually, you know, you feel like you lived a full life. And we started the Imagination Institute as a particular part of this field to understand how we can develop and measure imagination. We really do believe that imagination is a really crucial part of living a full life. And we can harness, like, imagination is a superpower, to use your, if I could steal your language for a second. It's a really important superpower that allows you to envision things, you know, future selves, future worlds. And then the research that we're finding shows that when you can envision this stuff, it actually does inspire you to realize it, you know?
Yeah, so that's really interesting. A really important part of Superbetter, of course, is imagining epic wins and envisioning the sort of strongest version of yourself, which we have our version of an avatar as your secret identity to help you do that. But so is your research suggests, or the research that you're building suggests, that having an active and healthy imagination is an important part of being happy and healthy, that it's, yes, it's actually a part of well-being.
Absolutely. You know, there's a lot of stuff in the media about, is there a link between badness and genius? And you know how, like, the media sensationalizes everything, right? But I think that the truth is that mental illness is not like mental illness all of us suffer, right? That's part of the Buddhist great, you know, observation, is that we live a life of 10,000 joys, 10,000 sorrows. And once we, like, get that out of the way and we recognize that, we can realize that we can channel all of our obstacles and trauma and stuff, we can channel into our creative expression. So I really mm-hmm. believe creative expression is intimately tied to self-expression.
Well, that's actually, that leads into a question I was going to ask you about your awesome new book.
Thank you. Is that the actual book?
It's the actual book!
It's not even out yet, Jane.
Oh my gosh. Spoiler alert. This is, when does it come out?
Like, I don't even have a copy. No, I'm joking.
It comes out December of this year, so soon.
December 29th. That's
December
right.
December 29th. Okay. So sneak peek. And by the way, I'm going to mail this copy to somebody who joined our live book club, because here you are, guys, hanging out with us. And so submit a question if you would like this book club. if you would like this book to be the next book that you read, and I'll follow up with you. I'll just pick somebody and I'll follow up with you after is to get this amazing book.
I mentioned you in there. Did you see it?
Yes, I actually did, because it's very soon. It's like in the first...
the play chapter.
Yeah. So you have the 10 things that highly creative people do that other people don't do. And the number one thing you say is play, more play, which is awesome. And we don't need to convince, I don't think, any of the Superbetter readers that more play is better. So that was really exciting. But I was really interested in some of the other things that you said, like... solitude and turning adversity into advantage, which you were just talking about, and sensitivity. Solitude and sensitivity, they sound kind of like they could be kind of depressing or anxiety producing. How do they relate to creativity?
You know, I think one of the interesting insights about or from some of these great thinkers, even going back to the 50s, like Dabrowski, we talked about Dabrowski, this psychiatrist, talking about how in order to get to higher levels of personality development, we have to have this disintegration process, meaning we have to get to the point where we feel like we don't even know who the heck we are anymore, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, and he found, you know, some of his great insights, which is now borne out by recent research, is suggesting that if you really want to have personal growth, you can't just stay in this state your whole life where you're just like, oh, I know who I am. I don't need to do anything to challenge myself or push myself, because you're lying to yourself. We never fully know who we are. You know, the person who says to you, I know who I am and nobody can tell me anything. You know, the second that you become closed off to hearing criticism, the second you become closed off to being honest about yourself, and that you're not personally growing, right? So, so I think that sensitivity chapter shows that the more that you're really sensitive, you know, you get into that state where you need to disintegrate in order to integrate. Is what that chapter is all about, and also the Aaron. In fact, right after I get off the phone with you, I'm having a chat with Aaron, Elaine Aaron, who did the highly sensitive person research.
Oh.
Podcast. So I have like an all-star cast evening. I'm so blessed. I get to talk to Elaine Aaron. But she did this amazing research on highly sensitive people, and a lot of great artists. You know, a lot of great thinkers. Are also deeply sensitive, you know, about the suffering of humanity, and as well as just very emotionally reactive. They feel it's sort of a form of aliveness, as Dabrowski said.
I like that. So that's really been a theme in positive psychology research lately. I feel like the idea that things that seem negative or you know, maybe have feel bad for a while are actually some of the most important things that we need to do more of to kind of be happy and successful and healthy.
Absolutely. I try to like go towards the things I'm most fearful of mm-hmm. as a habit. I try to get a habit of going towards the things I'm fearful of. It can be a habit itself, right?
Oh, battling bad guys every day is a habit.
I mean, I'm pretty sure the choir here. But like, something I like to do recently is I like smiling at strangers, and it makes like people really uncomfortable. But like some people like actually really, they're like, oh, that just like, that made my day, you know? Like, so you never know whose day you're going to make.
Oh, no, this is very exciting. We have our next guest has just joined us. This is Janina Scarlet, who is herself a superhero. Scott and Janina, you two should definitely join allies at some point. Scott, if you can, you know, if you stick around a few minutes and hear what Janina's up to. Janina, before we get to you, Scott, I would just say, you know, when I taught game design at San Francisco Art Institute, one of my favorite games that a student designed was all about smiling at strangers on public transportation in San Francisco. It was a zombie defense game. And there was a little notebook that you would carry around. The notebook got passed from student to student at the school all semester. And you would just try to convert, basically save zombies. And you know somebody is a zombie with the look on their face or like no emotion or expression on their face or zombie, but you can save them. Turn them back into human if you can get them to smile. So if you smile at them, and if they smile back, you've saved a zombie. You kind of keep a scorecard of how many zombies you saved on public transportation. And they passed around this book like a little like zombie survival guide. It was awesome. So I think you should try it, Scott.
I just love that. Yeah. I just love it.
Well, Scott, we have picked somebody to give your book away to. So let me select their question. So this is for Shay's son is going to be getting your amazing new book, Wired to Create. Scott, thanks for joining us.
Oh my gosh, it's always wonderful chatting with you.
People can find out more about the Imagination Institute by Googling Imagination Institute.
And yeah, imagination/institute.org.
And I really recommend people who've been interested in Superbetter, get involved with this research. It's a new area of research. You're going to come up with new tools to measure imagination, which and how it impacts people's lives in positive ways. So people should get involved with that research, and I'm going to get involved with it. I'm excited. Scott, have a good night.
Thanks, Jane. Can't wait to work with you.
Bye.
Bye.
And Janina is here.
Hi. Yay.
So for people who don't know your work, you are the legendary expert in something called superhero therapy. and you are writing a book right now called Superhero Therapy, which is basically like the companion guide, I think, in a lot of ways to Superbetter, or will be. And so, you know, before we talk about that, let me just give you a little bit of your credentials. So you're a clinical psychologist at the Center for Stress and Anxiety Management with the Veterans Medical Research Foundation and Sharp Memorial Hospital. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So you are a super legitimate, brilliant practicing psychologist who also happens to believe in the power of superhero stories and imagination to help people get stronger and better and have psychological well-being. So what is superhero therapy?
Superhero therapy entails incorporating characters from popular culture, for example, from comic books, from movies, television series, into evidence-based, which means research-supported therapies, such as cognitive and behavioral therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy, to help people recover from post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, depression, and a number of other disorders. And I find that when people first come into therapy, they have a really hard time identifying with their own emotions and their own experiences. Mm-hmm. But for a lot of people, it might be easier to talk about a different character. It also allows them to draw parallels between their experience and that of another character. And then over time, it also creates this experience of not being alone, of recovering, of healing. And I find that a lot of positive changes are coming from that, much as you're finding with Superbetter.
Well, now I have a silly question for you, but then a more compelling question. So, being a pioneer of superhero therapy, is Janina Scarlet your real name? Or, I mean, that is like the most superhero name I've ever
heard in your life. Thank you. I guess, to be completely honest, kind of like certain people that have experienced kind of adversity in their lives and then adopt a superhero name. When I became an American citizen, I changed my name to Janina Scarlet. Prior to that, I grew up in Ukraine. I experienced Chernobyl. I experienced a lot of persecution based on who I was and who my family were. And so I kind of went through my own adverse origin story, and then coming to the United States, it kind of gave me an opportunity to do something different, and connecting with X-Men specifically for me allowed me to develop this new sense that allowed me to understand that being different doesn't mean that it's a bad thing, and being different can actually empower you to make a difference, and it really helped me a lot.
That's amazing. So I didn't know that about you. I'm so glad to have learned that. And you know, I'm good. So I want to hear more about that. People are wondering, because they're like, oh my God, she's amazing. How do I find out more? So your website is Superhero Therapy. Is there a dash in there, or is it just?
Yes. Yeah. Superhero-therapy.com, or you can just Google Superhero Therapy.
Right. You're unrecognizable. Obviously, will be your site. So you posted recently, and I hope it's okay to ask about this. You posted about sort of one of the bad guys that you tend to battle this time of year, which is something that I battle, which is seasonal affective disorder. And actually, for the first time, got one of those big fancy lights, light boxes to try to use this winter, because I get incredibly anxious if it's gray. And it took me a long time to realize this, and not, I wasn't just like having a terrible life all of a sudden. It was the weather was making me just feel anxious. And I loved how you wrote about, you know, the the symptoms as a pink dementor, and you really drew on superhero mythology for that. Can you tell us just a little bit about how you like came up with the idea of the pink dementor, how that helps you?
Sure. So a dementor, for those of you that are unfamiliar with this, it's a fictional being from Harry Potter series, and it's meant to represent depression. It's this monster that essentially sucks the happiness out of you and makes you feel as if things will never be okay again. And of course, for those people that have ever experienced depression, whether it's major depressive disorder or seasonal affective disorder or another, that's kind of the feeling that we get, right? Like things will never be okay again. So I combine that, I call these depressive attacks dementor attacks, and I combine that terminology with a popular metaphor used in acceptance and commitment therapy, a pink elephant metaphor, where people are asked to think about a pink elephant, and once they imagine it, they're asked to do everything in their power to not think about it, not imagine it, not think of the words pink or elephant. And the idea is the more we try to control or suppress our feelings, the more we actually experience them. So rather than fighting with our emotions, the opposite would be to actually embrace them, to learn to live with them, and to learn to be a hero despite them or along with them.
I love that you mentioned that, because you know the pink elephant exercise is in the Superbetter book.
I remember that.
Using games as a tool to do that, but I really, you know, I like your approach of being present with it and not, you know, and living with it, and that is another battle technique, which is fantastic. So, you know, I'm asking everyone today for power ups. What are little habits or actions that we can take to get happier and healthier and stronger? And I was wondering if you have a favorite power up that you could suggest for everybody.
One of my favorite ones is to get people to talk or write about something that they're struggling with. It doesn't have to be the biggest, most difficult things to talk about, but maybe something that they would be willing to share. Maybe I'm struggling with whether it's weight management or whether it's anxiety or whether it's occasionally insecurity, whatever that is, and maybe to share it, whether it's on social media or with a friend or someone else. And the reason why I have people do that is because I find that it allows people to connect with other people, and also it allows other people to see that they're not alone. And by sharing our own experiences, we're encouraging others to open up and also to reduce some of the mental health stigma that unfortunately still exists today. So one of my favorite power-ups is actually to get people to talk about their own experiences in this kind of courageous and very heroic way.
Wow. And sometimes you can do that. I mean, in this case of your blog, you know, when you talk about it publicly, you don't have to call your mom and say, I'm struggling, you know, with something. You could even do it anonymously, I would think, maybe, you know, in a chat room or a forum or something. And even if you're just letting someone else hear, you know, that they're not alone, and maybe they see themselves in your struggle, your experience, that you could be helping somebody, which is
absolutely. And even sometimes leaving a note for somebody saying you're not alone. Again, it doesn't have to be you don't have to leave your name, but just letting someone else know that you're there with them and they're not alone in their experience can be really, really powerful.
I love that idea. I'm thinking now, like, that would be a great quest for everybody. To find, you know, somebody on Facebook or Twitter who might be having a hard day, and just, you know, to signify, you know, you're not alone. Like, that, awesome. Good quest. I'm going to do that. Yay. Well, we're trying to queue up our next guest. While we do that, why don't we see if there are any questions for Janina. It's loading. Let's see. There's lots of questions I should be answering here. By the way, I am still learning how to be awesome at Google Hangout. And this is like, I'm like, I think I got past like level one, but I'm like,
I was gonna say you're leveling up.
We've sent an invitation to our next guest who's not here yet, so I'm just, you know, I'm sure that sending two invitations doesn't really make it any better, but that's my instinct to do that anyway. Well, we'll see. Thank you so much for joining us, Janina.
Thank you.
You're awesome, and folks should Google Superhero Therapy and find you, and your book's going to be out like next year?
July of next year, yes.
So there'll be a new book about another superhero. Time. Everything's working out perfectly.
Thank you so much for joining us, Janina.
Oh, somebody needs
awesome, and folks should Google Superhero Therapy and find you, and your book's going to be out like next year?
July of next year, yes.
So, I can that sounds much better.
Okay, we stopped the loop. Yay.
Yay. All right. Thank you, Janina. We'll see you again soon. Book club for your book next year.
Bye.
Bye. Lise, we made it work. You're here.
Hi, Jane. How are you?
Good. For everybody who's wondering who our next guest is, this is Lise Worthen-Chaudhuri, who's on the faculty at the Ohio State University School of Medicine, and she has been our collaborator on the NIH-funded clinical trial testing Superbetter for mild to moderate traumatic brain injury for post-concussion syndrome. So Lise, thank you for joining us.
Hi, thanks for having me.
So we have two goals here with you today. One is to get the latest updates on the clinical trial. What did we learn about using Superbetter, specifically, you know, the app and the website to try to get through the agonizing process of recovering from a concussion? And then we're going to talk about something a little bit weirder, which you have a lot of expertise in neuroscience and dance, which is something that sounds like a superpower to me. So we're going to talk about that. But first, give us some updates on the research.
Yeah, so what we just presented at American College of Rehabilitation Medicine is the results of 10 people, all teens, right, 13 to 18 years old, 10 people who had concussion for at least 3 weeks and it wasn't resolving. So 10 people who played the game and 10 people who didn't, who all had standard medical care. So the only difference between these two groups of 10 was that one just checked in with Superbetter once a day. It was actually a really simple thing. Initially, we were like, oh, you know, we're going to figure out 10 minutes of material. And then we were like, they have concussion. Like 10 minutes might even be too much.
Yeah.
So we're just going to say just check in. It could be like a post. It could be check in on your bad guys. Did you have to fight the headache bad guy this time? So you just did it once a day. They did it once a day on weekdays. It took weekends off. And we found that actually every person who didn't have there were no other neurologic injuries, like nobody had Chiari malformation, nobody had, people had multiple concussions, but like nobody even had ADHD in addition to concussion. So that was kind of cool that we were able to sort of like really hone in on something. Okay, so the 10 people who played the game, actually absolutely none of them got worse in their concussion symptoms, and they significantly improved over the 10 who didn't play. The 10 who just had medical care, like standard medical care, it was kind of like flipping a coin. Half got better, half got worse.
Wow.
I mean, some were neutral in the middle. And the data kind of keeps coming in, and it just keeps reinforcing this trend that if you have just this even a small positivity intervention, this gaming positivity, heroic narrative intervention, all the things that Superbetter gives you, it can actually make a difference in your symptoms where nothing else is making a difference.
And this is because you were really close to this study, and you, I think, are able to have a better sense than a lot of people would is to what was really making this difference, because especially with so a condition like post-concussion syndrome where there's not a lot you can do. It's not like trying to recover from knee surgery and you have all these rehab exercises. And I mean, it's more frustrating. You kind of lack agency in the matter. And I do think that there's something about the agency or the, you mentioned positivity. What were you sensing was helping people?
I'll tell you, going into it, I was nervous. I mean, in writing and crafting the NIH grant and talking to experts, there were a lot of questions about whether people who, teens, right? I mean, these are teens, like they don't listen to anyone. They do things their own way. Whether teens could have enough creative agency to even play the game without it giving them a migraine, without it making the symptoms worse. So we really, in science, we have to be really careful about, especially with any kind of brain injury, is it even feasible? Can the people that you're talking about even tolerate this thing? You can't even jump to effect until you establish that it's safe. And there was a real question with backlit computer screens and the amount of creative agency that Superbetter requires, which doesn't seem like a lot if you're not concussed, but apparently can seem like a lot if you are. And I kind of just kept coming back to the argument, the person who created it was concussed when she created it. Yeah. It's the only thing that somebody who's concussed has created to help themselves. And it works for N of one.
Right.
We at least need to test it. Like, we can't discount it. And we got the grant. And it was amazing, Jane. Like, every person that played the game, was the creative agency wasn't an issue at all. And in fact, it felt to me like Superbetter gave enough structure and enough positive structure that creative agency actually became possible. Because, in any kind of an improv, like in dance, we do a lot of improv, theater-based improv. It's not a free-for-all. It's very structured. And then you're playing within the structure. And so to me, that's what Superbetter gave us. It gave us the structure that people could play positively within that enabled them to take ownership and to have some agency, to have that creative agency. And that actually falls into line with a lot of the current newer neuroscience on dance-based interventions, especially that include improvisation.
Oh, so say more. This is really interesting. So, we've created Superbetter as a possible intervention to help with traumatic brain injury recovery, but another creative practice like dance has also been studying chess, and that's something you have expertise in. So what's the relationship between dance and neuro?
Little bit of a jump. Stay with me. So there are several studies that I could go into right now, but there's one that I'm super excited about. There's this fabulous practitioner researcher, Glenna Batson, who is in the UK now, and she had people who had Parkinson's disease, which is another centrally mediated neural issue, right? It's from the brain and spinal cord that the deficits come, centrally mediated. So not like concussion, but similar in that way. Okay. So she looked at people with Parkinson's disease. She wanted to know if contact improvisation in dance could improve balance. So she showed improvements in balance, sure enough, even though one of the big issues in Parkinson's is freezing. Mm-hmm. You know, freezing all of a sudden wasn't an issue in contact improv. Where oftentimes, like gait initiation, it can be really hard to start walking. Like cognitively to tell your body, okay, walk now and have your body do that. All of a sudden with improv, initiation of movement wasn't such a big deal and balance got a lot better. Now, here's the really cool thing. One person that went through this protocol, she did an fMRI study of, and the fMRI study actually showed higher order neural processing. And in keeping with some of the new stuff on creativity. So what the theory is that in creativity, in cognitive load, the two halves of your brain, the alpha band, the alpha frequencies, they desynchronize. Okay, but they found that all of a sudden some things can make the alpha band synchronize between the two halves of the brain, and pretty consistently it's creative processing that's making it synchronize. And so the new stuff is saying, oh, this is really a brain thing. It's the efficiency of the two halves of your brain working together. And so the stuff that Glenna Batson is working on is roundabout, but it is in that same category, showing real brain changes with creative engagement and brain changes that are sort of in contrast to cognitive burden. So creative process turns out to be look really different in terms of the brainwaves than cognitive burden, and surprise, surprise, feel really different. So coming back to Superbetter, this, you know, so we're doing this cool stuff in dance. Glenn is doing this cool stuff in dance. I feel like Superbetter, it's probably, actually, it was something that we have to talk about, is do we want to look at some EEG response and see, is there, is one of the mechanisms underlying the effect that we've seen possibly synchronization of the alpha
frequency? We gotta put some players in an fMRI machine.
Right, exactly.
We would like to be put in an fMRI machine. Question, and we will call you first for this. Particularly if you're located near, you know, Stanford or OSU, would be helpful. The nearest fMRI machine to get your hands on. Lise, thank you so much for joining us. Do you have a dance power up to share? Like, if somebody wanted to tap into this creativity, what could they do?
All right, so. So has anybody done Breath of Fire, Kundalini Breath of Fire yet? That should be done. So like these short breaths where you pull your navel in and you always through your nose.
Okay.
You do it until you can't stand it and then you exhale. Okay, but something to like activate the sides of the brain. I would say Fosse hands. Just do Fosse hands, both Fosse hands.
Do I have to do it like a dragon?
Yes, okay. Kind of like a dragon. Yeah, there you go. That's good.
And this is getting the two sides of my brain to sync up better.
Theoretically, we have to do the study, Jane.
Okay, but so anybody at home who's not live streaming and is not looking ridiculous for all the world to see, but actually, that's kind of fun. Like, I'm like, what am I doing? This is fun.
You're doing Fosse.
That was not, I mean, I feel a little bit energized now. So people watching should do it, especially if people aren't watching you, then you won't have any edit. I like that, Lise. That's so weird. I've never done that before. And there's always something
thank
good.
You. Thank something you.
All right. Oh, I haven't even invited the next person in yet. Okay. So, wait, don't leave me alone.
No.
Let's see. The next guest we have is super interesting person who I want to invite. Okay, so we're inviting him now. And Lise, if people want to learn more about you, you're active on Twitter.
Yep.
And your Twitter handle is?
At Embedded Arts.
Embedded Arts. And so people who are interested in neuroscience and medicine and the arts, you are on Twitter as a researcher.
On Twitter, follow me, send me a message. Yep.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Lise. And while we're waiting for the next guest to join, I'm going to answer some questions from the stream. So thank you, Lise. We'll see you on Twitter.
Bye, everybody.
Okay. Questions. This is an interesting one. How did you learn to write a book like Superbetter as opposed to more traditional academic writing? You know, I actually learned using, I'm going to buy these. Eject. I actually learned to write, you know, popular science, if you will, the same way that I learned to write academic writing. When I started my PhD program, I just started reading all the academic journals and academic articles that were in my field, so that I could create a cognitive model of how the articles were. So when it came time to trying to write a popular book, I gathered up a lot of kind of successful books by people I admired and read them very systematically. When I was writing Reality is Broken, actually the model for me with that book was Michael Pollan's book on trying to kind of start a revolution of people wanting to, you know, understand where their food came from and to have a different relationship with food. And I was like, I want people to have a different relationship with games and understand how games work better. So that was, you know, I sort of pick books and try to get in my brain, you know, not just subconsciously, but actually I take notes on kind of rhetorical styles they use. And so I always recommend that to people. when you think you're going to write a book, find 3 to 5 books that are the type of book that you want to write and read that. So that is what I did. I had to close the stream. Okay. So I'm going to try to invite somebody else to join. Let me see about, let's send a little invite here. Sydney, everybody do the dragon snorting and the jazz hands. Let's see what's happening. I'm watching, no invitation. I have Gmail open, no invite. All right, invite should be in your stream, in the live stream. I'll invite again. Okay, let me try. You know, we're all learning this technology together. It's kind of fun. Okay, I'm gonna invite somebody else here. Sid, now that moving. Okay, we'll see who shows up first, and that will be exciting. Okay. This must be terribly boring for all of you guys, but you're very kind to bear with me. King 7. Okay, let's see who the next guest is. This is kind of fun. Like, who will show up? Maybe nobody. Maybe I will. Oh, wait. I see a friend.
Hello?
Joined us. It's Sydney.
How's it going?
Good, Sydney. Welcome to our secret book club. So secret that even the people I invite to join help to find us. So this is Sydney Rubin, everybody, who is an awesome member of our Superbetter community. You actually work as an assistant coordinator for the Positive Psychology Center at the University of Pennsylvania, which is really the heart of positive psychology world, where so many of the most, you know, important research papers come out of, and everybody who is fascinating, interesting comes by to talk and give lectures and collaborate. So yeah. You're kind of in the middle of it, and I was really excited to hear from you because you have been inspired to think about video games in relationship to all of this research. So why don't you tell us and the folks watching a little bit about what your interests are, and we'll see if we can sort of brainstorm around them.
Absolutely. So it's awesome to be at the Positive Psychology Center, really in the middle of everything. I get to work for the master's program in applied positive psychology. So I get to meet a lot of positive psychology practitioners, and I think a lot about sort of what's next in positive interventions. And I think that games are definitely going to be a part of that future. So what I've been thinking about recently, sort of the broad question that I've been exploring, is what a really large-scale, commercial, popular video game might look like if it were designed as a positive intervention, or with positive interventions sort of mixed in, maybe even covertly, but definitely with the intention of developing a player's well-being and helping them to flourish. So this leads me to my question that I had about some of the research in your book, Jane.
Go for it.
All right, let's do it. So in your book, you talk about the research that indicates there's a really big difference between people who are motivated to play games to either self-expand or self-suppress, so to escape the real world or negative feelings, versus to learn something and grow. And I was just thinking, it's so easy to use video games because they're so immersive. If you're feeling stressed out, it's really easy to just say, well, I'm going to spend some time playing a video game right now. And it'll help for a little bit. So I'm curious if, as a game designer, you have any thoughts about whether a game could be designed to actually nudge players who might already come to that game with a self-suppressive mindset, and help transform it so that they can be more self-expansive and benefit from having that motivation.
Well, that's interesting. So when I heard you were interested in that, it got the wheels spinning. And you know, there are a lot of games that have tried to help people not do so much self-suppressing, but they don't do anything positive as a springboard. So what I mean is, you know, there are a lot of video games that will tell you to take a break. You know, if you've been playing for a long time, you know, there'll be a little pop-up that says, hey, why don't you take a break and stop playing? Or, you know, I was just remembering Monkey Island famously, when you finished that game, when you'd won, there was a rather sarcastic message, you know, like, oh, congratulations, you beat the game. Why don't you go try to do something real now? You know, go or, you know, go ride a hike up a mountain or something. And it occurred to me, well, couldn't you do that in a more earnest way? You know, when somebody's been playing a game on their phone for 10 minutes, or they've just completed a level in a game that was really hard, could you message them and say, like, hey, that was awesome. That took a lot of, you know, creativity or determination. This is a great time to, I don't know, go do something that you've been putting off, you know, or you have an amazing mental focus now. You know, one thing that was really interesting that I learned in game research over the past couple of years was about the order in which you play games and study. So you know, a lot of parents tell their kids that you can only play video games when you've done your homework or you've done studying for the night. And so they'll like do their homework or studying, and then they play, you know, Call of Duty for 3 hours before they go to bed. Well, it turns out that if you play games after the studying, when you go to sleep, your brain keeps processing the game instead of what you were studying and learning. And so it's actually incredibly counterproductive to force people to wait until they've studied to play a game.
Right.
The correct mental order is play the game, get your, you know, attention and grit sort of fired up, and then go study, and then go to sleep, because then your brain will replay the study. So I thought, it does seem to me like there is a lot that we've learned that maybe we could try to put in. And it seems like maybe it should be a layer that you can turn on or off. Like when you start to play a game, like, would you like, you know, life tips or whatever? Would you like, would you like some sort of secret advice periodically as to what your brain might be tuned to do next? And I, you know, I hadn't really thought about that until you asked that question. So that for me was really kind of exciting. You provoked my curiosity really effectively. What is that, by the way? Would you, and could we study it? Because you were surrounded by people who study things. I mean, is that something we could try to, if we were to try to study, if it was helpful, do you think that would be possible to do?
Yeah, let's, absolutely. Why not?
I love it.
Yeah, well, it's great to hear your thoughts about this. That's so cool.
Yay. Now, Cindy, I have, I'm going to ask you if you have a power, but before I do that, help me help one of our allies, somebody I'm trying to bring into this hangout, who is watching the hangout, but cannot figure out how to accept my invitation. Where did you see your invitation to join?
So I kept my Gmail open because your first guest said that it came in through Gmail. Yeah, there should be like a like little chat thing that comes up, and then you say join.
Okay.
You go into a separate thing.
So if any of our other guests are watching, that's what you should do. And you should just jump in, even if I'm in the middle of conversation with somebody else. If you see that link, just join us. So it's a power up. Yes. So I'm interested if you have a power up to suggest.
Sure. Well, one of my favorite ones, it's actually, it's more or less from one of the power packs. It's essentially the human tag power up, which is basically about moments of positive social interaction, which I find really good to just keep in mind as being really important. Mm-hmm. But I actually changed the name to be a little more personal, and that works really well for me.
Oh, so can you tell, or is it?
It's what?
Can you tell? Is it too personal?
Oh, yes. So it's based on a really cool compliment that one of my friends once gave me. she described me as an oracle. And she meant that as a way of saying that, like, I gave really good advice and I was a good listener, and that I had some wisdom that I could offer people. So by renaming it the social oracle, it really allows me to remember this nice thing that my friend said about me, and recognize that connecting socially with other people is actually a strength of mine.
I love that. I think that's a good idea for everybody to like make a power of something that you just happen to be good at, you know, and that mm-hmm. it's nice to do things that are a particular strength for you. And you definitely use that power in reaching out to me and to all of us today. So human tag, I guess I'm it now, and now I'm going to try to tag somebody else. And, you know, I was just thinking also, if there are people watching who want me to just invite them and ask a question on video stream, that would be really fun too. So if you would like me to invite you to ask a question on the stream, you know, ask a question now saying, I will totally be on video, because that's why we did this on Google Hangout, so you guys could like hang out with us. Thank you, Sydney, and thank you. That's it.
Thank you so much. This was really fun. Thank you for having me.
Yay. Bye.
Bye.
And now we will see who else is brave enough to join me on camera while we try to loop in some of our other guests. Let's see. I'm going to invite another guest. And let's see if we can find her. I'm kind of juggling like a lot of windows here to make sure that everybody can find. Should be watching the live stream to join, I think. And let me send the link while you guys are all thinking who wants me to just call them. Look for an invitation. Okay. Let's see if anybody has volunteered here. Has anybody volunteered? Do I need to like move some questions? I haven't seen any new questions in a while.
Maybe. Hello, Jane.
Oh, yay! It's Annie!
Hi. Hello.
We are joined by, I think, one of the smartest people in the world right now. So this is Anne-Marie Roepke, who many of you are already familiar with her research. She coined the term post-ecstatic growth and has been a really influential researcher and practitioner in the field of post-traumatic growth. And you may also recognize her name as the author of a paper looking at the use of the Superbetter app for improving symptoms of depression. So Annie, welcome, joining us from Seattle today. How are you doing? How is Seattle today? Are you guys having the kind of weather that causes seasonal affective disorder yet?
No, we are. Actually, the light that you see is the glow from this sort of like light box style alarm clock that I got. I'm also surviving through learning.
What's that? I just got one. I just got my own light box, so.
You know, actually, it's a good power-up, is waking up to something that's sort of gentle and pleasant as opposed to a blaring alarm for those of us who aren't morning people.
Yes, I've heard about that. It's basically, it gets you to open your eyes before the alarm clock, the sound, triggers. Mm-hmm. I've read that. Yeah. That is, you find that is helpful.
I do.
Yeah. Well, good. So I thought we could talk a little about post-traumatic growth, because there was like a whole section of my book that I had to chop out because the book was already way too long and continues to be too long. But it was about, oh, and we have another friend joining us. This is Dr. K. Some of you may know from this super awesome book, If at First You Don't Succeed, Change the Rules. Dr. K, why don't you hang out with me and Annie while we chat, and then we'll turn it to you. Does that sound cool?
Absolutely.
All right, Dr. K, he's at a piano. Dr. K will be providing the musical entertainment for us.
Wonderful. I was curious about that.
He's going to be playing a Superbetter song for us, which is going to be amazing. So, yay. I'm glad we're all here together. Okay, so, Annie, you were the person who really explained to me and got me to understand that post-traumatic growth and post-traumatic stress disorder are not opposites. which many people think that they're the opposite of each other. Can you explain?
Yes, I'm so glad that you brought it up and that we have a chance to talk about this, because I think that there are a lot of really common and really unfortunate misconceptions about it. I think that if we take too much of a simplistic view, then it sounds like there's three buckets of people. Bucket number one is people that have post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. Bucket number two is people who are resilient, doing sort of fine. And then bucket three is people who have post-traumatic growth, who have this sort of profound positive transformation after trauma. And what's really too bad about that is that it makes it seem that if you're struggling with the trauma, if you're feeling depressed, if you're having PTSD symptoms, then it seems like there's no hope for you to bounce back from it or to grow in any way from the experience. And besides that being a discouraging, not very hopeful message, it's also just not accurate. So the thing that we know pretty clearly from the literature at this point is that there is a connection between post-traumatic stress disorder and post-traumatic growth. And the connection is that a lot of people who have PTSD symptoms also report pretty high levels of post-traumatic growth. So at first this can sound a little surprising, because on a conceptual level they seem like opposites, but let's imagine a person who is experiencing nightmares about the event that they lived through. Maybe they're feeling hypervigilant, so they're always kind of on guard to see who's around, don't love people being behind their backs. Maybe they have a startle response. Every time there's a loud noise, they really jump. And at the same time, they're feeling like their priorities are finally straight. They're feeling like they have closer, more intimate relationships with the people that have really come through for them. They're having a deeper understanding of existential or spiritual questions. And maybe they have sort of a more hopeful and flexible view about their future in some ways. So this person both has PTSD symptoms and post-traumatic growth, and they can really be there together. And there's some pretty complex relationships between the two that I could go into to be useful.
Well, so this is really interesting. I feel like, I mean, first of all, it's good news. So for people who are suffering, they haven't missed the boat. It's not like they, you know, are doomed now, oh, I'm not going to be one of the people who gets experience growth. I'm one of the ones who've been afflicted, you know. And it makes sense that, you know, in order to have that kind of transformative growth, that you really have to wrestle with something that has affected you deeply. And so in a way, the PTSD symptoms are a sign or signal that something is affecting you at such a deep level that that you will be wrestling with it, with that kind of, you know, in depth of intensity required to change for the better as well. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely one of the theories about why we see this relationship between PTSD and post-traumatic growth, that both of those are kind of tapping into how important and kind of earth-shaking this event was for somebody.
Yeah, because what do you make of the difference? What do you make of the difference? Is it that people who are experiencing post-traumatic stress are backing away from the experience, and people who are experiencing post-traumatic growth are moving into it? Or do you have some other idea?
Well, we're saying people experience both at the same time. That they're not. It's not an either or. That's what's so.
I'm thinking it may be a both at the same time, moment by moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. And we certainly do know that even though there's a relationship between post-traumatic stress and post-traumatic growth, it's not one-to-one. There are still certainly people who have PTSD without any growth whatsoever, and there are people who report pretty high levels of growth with really minimal PTSD symptoms. So, I mean, the short answer is that we really don't know what accounts for those different paths right now. It's one of the reasons that I really like being in this field of post-traumatic growth research, is it's so new and there's still so much to explore and so much to learn. But I do think that the theme that you're tapping into, Dr. K, is a really important one about being willing to sort of lean in and experience whatever your experience is. Because we know that one of the things that makes PTSD symptoms stick around is avoidance. So our really natural reaction is when something is really painful, we want to get away from it, right? It's the most normal, natural thing that there is, and a lot of times that serves us really well, especially in the short run. What we know is that for people who have symptoms sticking around pretty long after trauma, a big factor maintaining that is that they've gotten really clever and good at finding new ways to avoid everything that triggers that trauma. And when we invest so much energy into avoiding discomfort, it can make our worlds smaller and smaller and smaller over time,
yeah,
which can
both allow people.
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, Jane talked about that in the book, about that specific difference. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and so Annie, I mean, Superbetter, in the book, you know, we talk a lot about the things that are thought to help facilitate post-traumatic growth. And you're somebody who really has worked in developing concrete interventions. Is there something you can tell us about that seems to be promising as a means to help folks who maybe have PTSD, maybe are not having PTSD, but are looking for that path to post-traumatic growth?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the promising strategies actually relates to the topic we were just talking about, the way that trauma can kind of make your world smaller and smaller and smaller with time, especially if you're avoiding things. So one of the strategies that my team's been working on for promoting post-traumatic growth really has to do with kind of pushing the boundaries of your world so that it's larger and larger. So what does this look like? Well, it really looks like finding new opportunities that might not have been there before this adverse event happened. So, you know, for instance, if we just take your experience with all the work that you've been doing with Superbetter and the ways that I think it has made really meaningful contributions to other people's lives, I mean, do you think that you would have been doing exactly this work had you not gone through having a concussion yourself?
As many people have, you know, told me that maybe this was a blessing, you know, in a way, to go through this experience.
I'm so glad you brought up this idea that people tell you that, you know, maybe this is a blessing, because really one of the things that we are pretty confident is not going to be helpful for people for promoting post-traumatic growth is telling them at the outset, when they're really struggling with this difficult event, like, hey, look on the bright side. Look at the opportunities for growth. Because even if they are there, gosh, that's probably not what the person needs to hear right at that moment, right?
You've said, you know, point out in your research that many people who have post-traumatic growth still wish the trauma had never happened. Even though they say, I'm stronger, I'm happier, I'm closer to my friends and family, I have more meaning and purpose, if they could reverse it, you know, and not have the trauma, they would do that.
You would in a second. You know, a lot of the work that I've been doing is with people who have lost a loved one through all sorts of different circumstances, some through violence, some through suicide, some through natural causes, whatever the case may be. And a lot of these people have found elements of post-traumatic growth in their experience, right? But of course, in an instant, if they could snap their fingers and get rid of their new priorities and get rid of their appreciation for life and get rid of these positive changes in other relationships just to have this person back, you know, of course they would. And so I think it's really important to highlight that when we're talking about post-traumatic growth or when we're coming up with interventions to facilitate it, it's so not about glorifying or romanticizing adversity or saying we no longer need to take steps to prevent adversity and trauma from happening because, hey, it'll be good for people in the long run. You know, it's not about that at all. It's about accepting that if there is a certain amount of unavoidable adversity and pain that we're going to encounter in life, is there a way that we can wring something of some value from it as we move forward?
And I think, you know, a lot of people who've heard about post-traumatic growth now or they've read the book, and maybe they're not going through a period of trauma or adversity themselves, they want to help others. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, they're trying to figure out, you know, what can I say and what should I not say? And we definitely, from my own experience, the thing I hate hearing, you know, people say to me, you know, in a way, getting hit in the head was the best thing that ever happened to you. Because now you've got to, you know, write this book and help so many people, and it makes me crazy. And, you know, listening to you talk today made me think for the first time that, you know, maybe one of the helpful things that you can say is just to reflect to them the strengths that you see in them. You know, I really admire, you know, how you've just been able to express your love through this tragedy, or how you've continued to, you know, show up for your family through this tragedy. What, you know, that if you have a friend or loved one who's going through something and seems to be showing some of these personal strengths that might be a part of their where they come to understand their own strengths better, maybe that would be more helpful than, you know, saying, well, count the blessings of this, you know.
Right. You know, and actually we do an activity that's similar to that in the post-traumatic growth intervention that we've been developing and testing over this last year and a half with my team at Penn. So, you know, a lot of times if we look back on challenging experiences that we've had, it's so easy for so many of us to go to the ways that we were lacking, the ways that we messed up, missed out, or failed, right? And a lot of times there are very real, very profound strengths that we've shown, but they kind of get lost in the chaos of the regrets and the sadness, right? And so we might not even notice the ways that we've showed that character strength or that virtue or that fortitude. And so one thing that we help people to do is sort of revisit some of these memories that they had within this strengths-based framework of looking for ways that they actually did behave in ways they were proud of, and where there's social support for other people to help them find that as well. In terms of what you can say, though, really to someone who's in the thick of it right now, going through adversity, you know, I don't know that there are words. I don't know that there is any magic statement. I think that something that has been true for me and that I've heard over and over and over again from people I've worked with in our post-traumatic growth study and in my clinical work is, you know, people just want you to be there. They don't want you to try to fix it necessarily. They don't want platitudes. They don't want advice. They kind of just want to know that you're there with them, that you're there in it, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that goes a long way. I'm actually reminded of the movie Selma. I don't know if you've seen it. Mm-hmm. But there's a really, right, so it's about the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. There's a really beautiful scene where he's approaching the parents of a young man who was killed in really unjust, tragic circumstances. And you know, when he approaches him, he says, there are no words to express my sorrow for what you've lost, but, you know, God was the first one to cry when your boy died, something along those lines. And I think what's really profound about it is that he's not trying to fix it. He's just saying, I'm here with you in your sadness. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not. I think that can go a really long way.
Well, thank you for, this is very, we got very deep, which is a wonderful way to be tonight. Thank you for joining us, Annie. And if folks are interested in kind of keeping up with your research or research in the field, where would you suggest that they look?
So let's see, a few places. So the research group that I'm a part of has a website called the Growth Initiative. So it's growthinitiative.org. I have a personal website that is infrequently updated, annemarieroepke.com. That might have to go on the to-do list.
Link to that from the Superbetter resources site. So if we're folks know where that is, they can.
Thanks for that. Yeah.
Great. All right. Well, thank you. Have a good night. And you're all set up for Hugely, like the kind of warm, cozy candles and your light box.
Yes, exactly.
Enjoy.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate you having me on, and I also just want to say thanks to your readers, not only for tuning in tonight, but also because I suspect that some of them are the same folks that participated in our Superbetter research or have participated in other research in the areas of post-traumatic growth or positive psychology. And really, so much of what we know about these phenomena really depends on people being open and willing to share those experiences so honestly with us. So I do want to just express profound gratitude to anyone who's tuned in, who's ever taken part in research.
Yes, good. I share that gratitude with you. So thank you, everybody. Yeah. Annie, we will talk soon. Thank you so much. Yeah. Bye.
Okay, take care. Have a good night.
And Dr. K, we are hanging out with Dr. K, who, thank you for hanging out and being so kind of my wingman there for the interview. That was
absolutely.
That was a surprise. This is Dr. Kaylin Hammond, and what is your book? Here it is. Yeah, so this is great. So I have a copy of your book, which is, was this the first book you wrote?
Right, a while ago.
Yes, but I love it because it's clearly got such a gameful spirit. If at first you don't succeed, change the rules, which is kind of, you know, absolutely what every game designer, you know, learns to do. If you want to change how people are behaving, and treating other players, you should change the rules. And you are an expert in how we treat each other. You are the original relationship rescuer. That's what you're an expert in. And I was so excited to hear from you as somebody who has played Superbetter and has a great story about it, but also as an amazing expert in this field of psychology and relationships who can teach us some amazing power-ups. And you are, I just really want to get to your power-up because you have this really cool story, something that we can learn to do that will dramatically improve a relationship that might be struggling or failing. So lay it on us.
Okay, well, a couple actually.
Oh, cool.
Well, three. First, what Anne-Marie was saying, there's a lot of research, really good research, about what people who live happily ever after do. And there are people who live happily ever after. There are couples who do a few fairly simple things that other couples don't do. And a lot of those have to do with the kinds of things that all of us do naturally when we're dating. But we stop, many of us stop after that. So one thing I actually want to do is I want to ask anybody who's watching who wants to join me in a quest, in a, I've taken on, I can even hardly say it. I want to change things so a million kids who would have grown up in unhappy homes grow up in happy homes because their parents learn how to have the kind of relationship that'll make that possible. And one way to do that, I pulled together a bunch of this research in a new book that's called Date Your Mate, How to Save Your Marriage from the Blahs and Live Happily Ever After. And it's going to come out fairly soon. And what I've done is on my website, drkonline.com, I've set a place where people can sign in. And then there'll be a day when anybody who has signed up gets to buy it for a dollar.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, so it's drkonline.com, and then you can get the book for a buck.
That's amazing, and we're going to...
I want people to learn it for themselves so that their kids are great. I want them to tell everybody else about the book. That's my...
and I love how you're linking it to, for kids at home to have, to be in a house where there is love and not conflict and struggle.
Yeah, my parents were divorced. I know what it's like. My parents were divorced. It's not necessary.
Can you teach us quickly one of these things
I know we're low on time. One is my favorite bumper sticker. Mm. Don't believe everything you think. Because just as Anne-Marie was saying, when our amygdala hijacks our brain, basically, it shuts down our frontal lobes where we can do most of our thinking from and throws us into fight, flight, freeze. And one of the things that happens is that our psychological field narrows, and most of what we notice is threats. So all of a sudden, when we're in that state of being upset, anybody can recognize this if you think about it, you feel like a jerk, you think your partner is a jerk, you feel like an idiot for being with this person, your picture of your relationship is that it's a disaster, but that's all an illusion. It's like those signs that say, on your car mirror, objects may be closer than they appear.
Right.
You know, when you're in an amygdala hijack, things may be better than they appear.
I want to put like all around my life.
Yeah.
Things may be better than they appear.
Right. And it looks really real to you at the moment. But if you understand how an amygdala hijack works, you can make an adjustment. You say, I know it looks terrible right now, but now is not the time to decide. Mm-hmm. I'll decide later. I'll still be able to see the negative stuff, but I'll have the perspective to see the positive and the resources and so forth and to make a real evaluation of what's going on. I don't have that now.
And how long do you need to wait, or what can you do to kind of reverse the amygdala hijack so that you're making it from a clearer state of mind?
Almost certainly, you can wait about 20 minutes. The chemicals will metabolize and so forth if you don't keep going over and over and over what you're upset about.
Ah.
So you can go for a walk.
You can do
yoga. You can take a breath.
It
doesn't have to take 20 minutes. And that gets to my second power up. Somebody asked Mikhail Gorbachev, Tony Robbins actually, asked Mikhail Gorbachev, what happened? How could it be that the United States and the Soviet Union that were at each other's throats, you know, could have reached a rapprochement? What stopped the Cold War?
Mm.
And Gorbachev said, it happened when I first met your President Reagan. We were talking with each other, and pretty soon he started lecturing me about the evils of communism. And I was lecturing him right back about the evils of capitalism. and our voices were going up, and we were getting more and more upset and more angry with each other. And all of a sudden, he stood up and turned around and turned away from me. I was shocked. I thought he was leaving. And then he turned back with a big smile on his face, and he said, "Let's begin again. Yeah. My name is Ron. May I call you Mikhail?" And when he said that in that way, I knew that I could work with this man.
Wow. Did you think there's something physically, because in Superbetter, one of the power-ups that we recommend and that's been researched, this idea of getting back into bed for like a cognitive reboot.
Yeah, I remember you mentioned that.
Yeah, if you're having a bad day and you just kind of want to feel like you need to restart so you're not kind of ruminating and it's getting worse and worse.
Yeah.
Literally get back into bed, pull the covers over your head, and then, you know, wait 30 seconds and then get up like you just woke up. It's a new day.
Absolutely. But you know, there's a bigger generalization than that. I don't know how well it's been researched, but it's clear in my practice and it's clear with other people I've spoken with. And by the way, that process works with a spouse also, because I do it with my wife. Yeah. And what I'll do is we'll start to get into it, and I'll remember Gorbachev, and I'll say, "Wait a minute, let's begin again." And I'll go out of the room, and I'll come back in a different frame of mind.
I like this. That is very practical.
And it works. And just like, if you think about it, you're in the middle of a fight with somebody, and the telephone rings. And you answer it, and you go, "Hello." And you're having a wonderful conversation with somebody in a totally different place. You know, there's that hydraulic theory of emotion that you somehow have to get it out. You don't. Where did it go? Your emotion happens because of the thinking you're having in the moment. And as soon as your thinking changes, your emotion changes. So it's the generalization is basically dropping the thought you were having.
Yes.
And when the thought is gone, the emotional state is gone.
I like that. I feel like I could use this at work too. But then I get into kind of tense meetings sometimes with, you know, we work in these very big project teams and we're arguing for our point of view. I feel like I could use that. Okay, so I was also very excited.
Wait a minute. Let's start over.
Yeah. yeah. And leave the room and then come back. So I was really excited also just to hear a little bit more about your story. And we had this idea that what would be better for a Superbetter book club than to have an epic win live on air. Playing Superbetter with a special ally, and your challenge has to do with playing the piano. And so tell us a little about what you've been doing, and then we have just a couple more guests. This would be a perfect musical interlude for us.
Musical interlude. I love it.
Yeah. So what are you doing?
I'm really excited about the idea. What happened? I mean, when my daughter was growing up, I was on the road a lot, leading workshops, and we didn't really connect in the way that I wish that we had. And when I got your book, I had the idea of starting a game with my daughter who lives in San Francisco. And the game is to get me back playing the piano, because I have loved playing the piano and haven't been doing it much recently because I felt too busy and so forth. All this other stuff I was doing. So I started this game with her. And one thing she did, I said, you know, "I want to get to playing the piano, but I just don't do it. You know, how can I do that?" And she told me something that wasn't rocket science, but it was very powerful, which is she works for Facebook and she gets a lot done. So I figured she's good at this. She said, you know, block out some time on your calendar and set an alert to go off. And when the alert goes off, stop whatever else you're doing and go play the piano.
Drop and play.
So I did that. And also she sent me some really cool songs that are quite different from what I've ever played before, which I'm not ready to play yet. My favorite is The Flight of the Cosmic Hippo by Bella Fleck.
Oh, wow. Really cool.
I recommend it out on YouTube, The Flight of the Cosmic Hippo. But anyways, so here's the kind of stuff that I have played in the past and I'm beginning to play again.
Okay? Oh, wow.
And I've never done this on the air, so this is a real epic win. I mostly play for my own amazement. Let me turn it, put this on so you can see. Whoops, can you still see me?
Yes.
Okay. Something happened. There we are. Okay.
I had no idea what we would hear if you would turn out to be a musical genius, which you kind of are. That was beautiful. That was very like jazzy, the version of that. Thank you so much. That was a real power up to listen to you play. Now, if people want to know more about your project to change a million homes for the better, your Dr. K relationship rescue, they can Google that and find you very easily.
Probably they wouldn't find that. They would just find
drkonline.com. Thank you, Dr. K, for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure. It's such a delight.
Yay. Well, it's so fun for me to meet amazing people in the Superbetter community and learn what they're doing, and what you're doing is awesome.
Yeah, you're putting great people together. This is just wonderful, Jane.
Oh, yay. And you should be playing the piano. Like, you should be streaming all the time. I would listen to you any night. You know, I think that should be something. Talk to your daughter about. You should, like, stream a concert for your friends and family.
That's very kind of you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. All right, have a good night, Dr. K. Thank you.
You too.
Okay, well, we have a couple more folks waiting to come in, and if you're watching and you have that invitation, you guys should hop in, and in the meantime, here we come. I see we have
people. It's so fun for me to meet amazing people in the Superbetter community and learn what they're doing and what you're doing.
You have to shut the other window. Okay.
This is just wonderful.
Oh, yay. And you should be playing the piano. Like, you should be streaming all the time. I would listen to you any night. You know, I think that should be something.
Keith, I have muted you while you can find. There should be, I think you've got two windows open. One of them is on delay. So you want to close that one where you were watching, and then I will let you sort that out while we talk to Josue, who is joining us, who is the genius behind Geek Therapy.
Hey, Jane.
How are you doing?
Good, good, good. Powered up after Dr. K's epic win.
That was kind of awesome. I think it's always an honor to be present for someone else's epic win. And frankly, he was really good. That could have gone different ways. I mean, could have been Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. We didn't know what that was going to mean.
Yeah.
That was really good. So you are a leader also in this community. We were hanging out with Janina Scarlet earlier tonight in the book club, who's known for her work in superhero therapy. And you have a podcast and a blog around geek therapy. You are a licensed counselor. You help people in your everyday work as well. Can you just tell us a little bit about this geek therapy project and what you're interested in, what you're excited about?
Sure. So geek therapy started as an act of rebellion when I was working at a in a mental health role at a school, and the there was a video game system available to me to be able to use with the kids, and my supervisor didn't want us to. She was very hesitant about video games, and as an act of rebellion, I created, kind of just started curating new sites and research. One of the first things I posted was your first TED Talk.
Oh.
And yeah, it's pretty cool. It's still up there. It's not a lie. And I just started collecting news sites for that, and news articles and research, and people, like my clients, would start coming to me because they saw the Geek Therapy thing. Then it became a blog, and it became a podcast, and I started interviewing people like I've had Janina on the show. And one of the things I really wanted to kind of promote was this idea of like taking whatever you're passionate about, you know, being geeky about something and using that in whatever your other profession is. And it just so happens that I was working in mental health at the time. I knew a lot of psychologists. So it was cool to see people like Janina, who would, you know, call themselves geek therapists and then go on to create something like superhero therapy. It's very humbling. It's very exciting to see people kind of taking that idea on. And yeah, and that's kind of what geek therapy is. It's kind of my celebration of how geek culture is saving the world. And
yeah, and
so I have an idea on how I want to continue to grow that in the future, very, very soon. And,
can you share it, or is it top secret?
No, it is not top secret. So my favorite episodes have always been the stories about people just talking about how something really, really made an impact on them. Like a girl who was in a wheelchair after an accident, and she was playing Tomb Raider, and she could see herself walking, you know, through Lara Croft. And then she started having dreams where she could walk, and it was kind of living out those adventures. And hearing people tell those stories is so great. And I've been obsessed with podcasts that are more documentary style. So my plan is to start just doing, instead of interviews, doing documentary style stories. So really like geek culture, like feel good stories about geek culture. That's what it's going to become in the future.
As early as
January. Yeah.
Well, I'm sure some of the people who are here in our book club now live or will be watching this video on YouTube later might be exactly the kind of people who have lived those stories. Before I ask another question, I want to make sure people know how to find you. It's geektherapy.com, right?
Yep, that's geektherapy.com.
And you're on Twitter, too, and you're not a hard person to track down. So that's so people who are here with us now and will be watching later will have many of those stories to tell. I wanted to ask you, you talk about geek culture taking over the world. Something in psychological research that's been increasingly important over the past decade is trying to figure out if different interventions are really effective globally. You know, in the field of positive psychology, there's been a real push to figure out, you know, maybe some of the interventions that test effectively in the United States are much harder to implement, let's say, in a country like Japan. We do a lot of strengths coaching in positive psychology and talking about what you're good at, and in certain cultures, the urge to be humble and modest is so strong that people really feel awkward trying to say anything positive about themselves. And I think it's interesting. I know that you recently took the idea of geek therapy abroad to the Latin American audience. And I'm wondering, in your experience, do you think that this concept of geek culture, is it really global? Is it something you have gotten a positive response to from the world, you know, not just in the U.S., especially, you know, where I'm in California, we're all geeks, but,
yeah. Yeah, right, like if you're in the San Francisco area, everybody's a technology geek, right? Yeah. And I've been to San Diego Comic-Con, and that is the biggest geek culture convention, right, in the United States. And so I did get to go to Bogota in Colombia, and it was amazing because everything that we like here, they like there. And right now, I think the best answer, the best way to answer your question is Star Wars.
Mm.
Right? Like Star Wars is everywhere right now. You could look up the trailer in every language right now. It is, the whole world is waiting to see it.
And by the way, I just heard that the China trailer has more scenes than our trailer does. So even if you don't understand it, you should watch it.
Yes. Yep. Thank you.
Good tip.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that when I went to Colombia, everybody is, sometimes they read the comic books in Spanish, but sometimes they don't. And the biggest characters, like America, is very, very influential in terms of geek culture. So there are just so many superheroes, so many themes, so many, again, popular movies that that are kind of universal, and it's really cool to see. And you know, when you talk about research, a lot of the research that we see is coming out of Western countries, right? The United States. There are a lot of cool studies from Japan, but not every country is represented, and not every subculture is represented. And it's really good to keep in mind that what you're doing here may not apply in another place, because a cultural nuance, doesn't matter how small, it can make a huge difference.
Yeah, well, it's very exciting for me to hear you say that. I mean, that resonates with me. Well, especially when you think about superhero stories in particular, and how, you know, the films today, they reach all the markets. It makes me feel good, because, you know, I think looking for this commonality of culture, it's really a beautiful thing. I was just saw a statistic that Candy Crush Saga is the single largest social network after Facebook and YouTube. Is that currently there are more than 500 million people actively playing this game. And so, you know, when I'm like at the airport or on the public transportation, or I'm sitting in a cafe and I look and I see somebody else playing Candy Crush, like, to me that's very easy to connect with anybody. I can say, oh, what level are you on? And if it's I'm in the 700s, so odds are I have played that level, and I like take a peek at it, and maybe, you know, I helped a stewardess with a level on a flight the other month, and, you know, I felt good about that. And I love the idea that we're increasingly having more common culture. And some people say, you know, oh, too many of our media is superhero-based now. It's all TV shows and movies. But there's something about how universally appealing it is, which is one of the reasons why they get made so often, is that they won't be successful just in the U.S. They'll be successful globally. It's kind of amazing that we can, especially with so many other things that we fight about and disagree about and don't understand each other about, that we can have this growing geek culture that feels like we have so much in common.
I think you'll find this pretty interesting. Janina is actually a part of this too. There's a book called The Walking Dead Psychology. And I contributed a chapter to it on positive psychology. So it's essentially a positive psychology primer through minority characters in The Walking Dead. So taking The Walking Dead TV series, video games, and comic books and using it to talk about positive psychology. So I just heard from the editor of the book that the book is being translated into Spanish. So, and Russian, I believe. So the book is going to be translated into different languages. So many countries, especially, I mean, Russia's huge, and so many countries speak Spanish. So how many people are going to maybe get their first taste of positive psychology just because they are Walking Dead fans? How cool is that?
I love that. Well, that is good news. So, Jose Cardona, you run Geek Therapy. You are awesome. You're a part of our Superbetter community, and now you have hopefully inspired many people to become part of your Geek Therapy community as well. Thank you for joining us. I'm like excited. Walking Dead. You can teach everything through zombies. I've seen like earthquake survival taught through zombies. This is a You're onto something. This is great. All right, well, have a good night.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye. You too. Bye-bye.
And now I'm going to unmute my friend Keith, who, let's see, Keith, how you sound. Have I unmuted you successfully? Oh, yes, there you are.
Can you hear me now? Hey, Jane.
Perfect. So, everybody, this is Keith Wakeman. Keith Wakeman, the CEO of Superbetter, and a longtime friend of the Superbetter project, was working with us when we were first developing the app and website to really try to make it as helpful as possible for people who are trying to adopt healthier habits in their lives and really make positive changes. And now you're our CEO, which is amazing.
It is amazing and very cool.
And I thought it'd be great just to end our book club tonight by having you share with folks some updates from the world of the app and the web platform. Where are we going?
Yeah. Well, happy to, and to bring everyone up to speed. You know, I'm leading a new team based here in Chicago and beyond. Jane is our chief science officer, so we're a national team, but we're working to really unleash. We talk about unleashing the potential of Superbetter. It's such a great tool, and so many more people should have access to it in very different ways. And so we came together and earlier this year, and you know, we're moving forward towards hitting milestones, and you know, so you know, step one was building out the new team. Step two was, you know, making the product great again and getting it where it's a really great experience. We updated the product. We reintroduced an Android app, which was the number one thing that our community had been asking for. So in September, all of that happened, so we've got, you know, good products that are out there. We just love this idea of living gamefully and thinking like a gamer and how that can help us achieve goals in our real lives and help us tackle challenges, you know, big and small. And a lot of activity around really spreading that message, creating awareness. And so all of that was kind of our milestones for the fall. And now we're there's a couple of things happening. One is around the product with a project we call Superbetter 2.0, and that's a project to add continue to evolve the experience. And we are, you know, we're blessed with such an amazing community, over 500,000 registered users and with a great source of feedback on, hey, this is really working, or this is a great feature. And so we have a lot of areas to where we would just, you know, we just have new insights because folks are using this in different ways. So Superbetter 2.0 is about taking Superbetter to the next level, improving the experience, adding some new features as well. So that's a project that
is the feature that I'm most excited about that we're trying to build out right now is the ability to create a power pack to share with others, because we have had so many creative people play Superbetter and so many, you know, amazing experts in something, whether they're teachers or they're therapists or they're artists, and they want to make a power pack to help somebody else achieve their goal or learn a really powerful technique. And that would be, to me, that is the best possible place for Superbetter to be, so that we can empower the community to share what they know and what they've tried. And even if you're not an expert in something, if you've been through something, and here are the power-ups that worked for me and the bad guys that I battled and the quests that I did that really made me feel like I was on the path to recovery, that's amazing for somebody else who's going through the same challenge to be able to go to do that.
It is, and you know, how powerful that is. You know, from a peer, you know, I've gone through this, now I want to share, and you know, the power pack I've created can help other people. Is a user, and also we have a lot of coaches that use Superbetter with individuals that they're coaching, or therapists that are using Superbetter as an adjunct to therapy and support. So the sharing feature also enables that kind of customization around you know, groups, individuals that are helping to coach others in specific areas. So that's a really exciting one, Jane, as well. And then on the the product, we're working to make it better and we'll continue. It's an ever evolving process, and we'll keep making it better and better and better, and allow that to help more and more people. And life is good there. And then the other is one of the ways that we can help get Superbetter in the hands of more people is through partners that have access to a lot of people and align strategic interests. So the other area that we're having a lot of just really fascinating and exciting conversations around are large organizations that are mission aligned with Superbetter, that just want, they see the potential, they love that it's an engaging platform that has this really fun and helpful an evidence-based process of living gainfully in our real lives. It has studies behind it, and you know, so there's a lot of interest in how Superbetter can help achieve some of their objectives, large health plans, both in the U.S. and abroad, and other types of groups. So I can't talk about the specifics of those, but no, there's some really amazing things that are in the pipe, and some of those will come out the other end and just be really, really amazing things for Superbetter and for the people that it can help.
And will help us continue to learn more about it. You know, as the chief science officer, you know, the more people we have playing, the more robust, you know, our data set is, so that we can really dig even deeper and learn more and get more detailed about, you know, which power-ups really are universally the most helpful and which power-ups, you know, are more effective during the winter, you know, because everybody's got seasonal affect disorder, which is like the obsession that I have today. Well, that's great. And, you know, this is really exciting time for Superbetter, I think. We're, you know, very grateful to all of the people who have used it and helped us make it better, and we'll keep doing so.
Great. And if you're watching because you've read the book and you haven't been on the website or downloaded the app, we, you know, one of the things we did recently is we made the apps free. And so, you know, tonight, you know, on your to-do list, you know, go to superbetter.com and you can click through to download the apps right from the website or register if you haven't done that yet. But it's a great tool. You know, I'd encourage you to, if you've enjoyed the book enough to be on this call, you will, you know, very much enjoy the experience of the app and the website.
It's worth letting people know, you know, the web platform has always been free. The apps are free now, and we're committed to having a full version of the Superbetter experience free. And there will be bonus experiences that, if you are looking for a little extra Superbetter wisdom and guidance and coaching, that you will be able to pay money for, which will be great to support the future of Superbetter. But I'm so proud that we can make the app free now, as well as the website, because it's such a helpful tool for so many people, and we've got the science to show that it's helpful. And so for it to be free, so there's really truly no barrier for somebody to try this and see if it helps them, as is just the best thing in the world. So I'm so happy about that.
It's great. It's terrific.
All right, well, we have kept everybody up past their bedtime or their dinner time. So I should thank you, Keith, for joining us. And the apps in the store, the Google store and the iTunes store, and the website is superbetter.com. And they should follow us on Twitter or like us on Facebook to hear updates. Just hang
out with Superbetter. That's right. That's right. Perfect. Perfect.
Thank you, Keith. Perfect.
Thank you, Jane.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
All right, thank you, everybody. That was my first time doing this, so I learned a lot, including to factor 50% more time per guest. But this is really cool, and I'd like to do this again in the future, because the Superbetter community is super cool. And as you can see, so many interesting people doing cool research or cool practice and leading really interesting, amazing lives that I hope that, you know, even if you weren't live on the broadcast, on camera, you know, you see that you are part of this community too, and you are probably one of those amazing people doing great research and leading extraordinary lives. And so the next time we do this, you know, please reach out to me if you'd like to be one of the folks in our book club on camera. I'd love to do this again. And you can do that just by writing me at jane@superbetter.com. Let's put the subject guest if you'd like to pop up and talk with us and share some of your work or share your experience or do an epic win on camera, which that was my favorite part of tonight. Thank you, everybody. And this whole archive will be on YouTube forever. So if you've missed any of it and like to go back and watch it, as soon as I hang up, it will go to YouTube and you'll be able to watch it using the same link that you used to get in here, and you can share the link with anybody else. Thank you, guys. Have a good night. Do your power-ups, and I will see you in Superbetter. Bye.